So Frontier Economics is an economics consultancy. We've got offices around Europe, and we work across all sectors, but energy is our largest specialism. And for the last few years, we've been working on the challenges and opportunities associated with the low carbon transition. And as part of that, looking at hydrogen and working for both policymakers, regulators, producers, investors, and retailers as well across the energy sector. So just to introduce our work before I hand over to Maria Paula. So Matrix commissioned us to develop a vision for hydrogen in Northern Ireland, to look at the barriers that might prevent that vision from being realised, and the enablers, and to develop an action plan for overcoming those barriers and for building on the enablers. And finally, to consider the wider economic impacts associated with all of this. And we undertook this work in parallel to the EY study that's previously been presented, with a kind of greater focus on the longer term. But as you'll see, many of much of what we have covered is very complementary. So how did we do it? We first considered the literature and undertook desk research and analysis. First of all, to understand the wider Northern Irish vision, so as presented so well earlier, around self-sufficiency, net zero, and a thriving local economy. But also to systematically assess the characteristics of potential supply of hydrogen in Northern Ireland and potential demand sectors in Northern Ireland, taking into account the economic characteristics of supply and demand, the resources in Northern Ireland in particular, and existing infrastructure and industries. And we did that using a methodology that we've applied in quite a few, or building on a methodology that we've applied in quite a few geographies, including Scotland, Canada, and Morocco, just to name a few. We then engaged extensively with stakeholders, and a big thank you to all of the stakeholders who participated in the work who are here today. So we undertook 10 one-to-one interviews and three big stakeholder events, and we asked stakeholders about their vision, about barriers and enablers, and what they would like to see to overcome those barriers and to build on the enablers. And we really got a lot out of that engagement. And then finally, we looked at the wider economic impacts, and our focus there was primarily on the potential contribution that hydrogen could make to an efficient low-carbon economy, and driving down costs and helping to meet net zero in the most effective way. But we also undertook an analysis of the jobs and GVA that could be supported by investment in this area. With that, I will hand over to Maria Paula.
Thanks, Claire. Good morning, everybody. So we started our analysis by setting out the objectives for a low-carbon hydrogen economy in Northern Ireland. And to do that, and building in policy priorities from the energy strategy, and also following our stakeholder engagement, we identified two big areas. One, the key one, is supporting energy and climate policy priorities, particularly supporting decarbonization. And the second one, developing specialisms. So let's start with the first one. We undertook, as Claire mentioned, we undertook desk research to understand the characteristics of demand and supply in the short term, so to kickstart the sector, and also in the long term. And what we found is, on the supply side, there is a strong focus on green hydrogen. Why is this? This is consistent with the renewable capabilities in the island. This is also consistent with the increasing relevance of security of energy supply, particularly ensuring energy independence. It is also consistent with the lack of carbon capture and utilization and storage infrastructure, and also the fact that even when that infrastructure is or these methods are in use, some residual emissions are left, which is not fully consistent with net zero aims. So that is on the supply side. On the demand side, we identified that mobility is actually the anchor sector in the short term, and as we have been, or various people have mentioned earlier, ride bus activities already provide some insights of this capability. The energy strategy has also identified mobility as a key sector, as you can see in the chart at the left-hand side, as the key sector driving demand in the long term, so towards 2050. Heat, or in particular in the short term, blending is the second sector, in the short term as an anchor sector. Blending would be possible today. However, there is a bit of uncertainty with respect to the role that it would play in the future. And you can see this already by the fact that, again, in the left-hand side, when we see there are two scenarios with significant difference with respect to how much demand from heat we will see. And what is underlying here is the fact that, of course, whatever is developed should be developed, hopefully, in a cost-efficient way, and electrification could be also, direct electrification instead of 100% hydrogen utilization could be an alternative, could be an alternative, and therefore some uncertainty with respect to this sector. Another sector is industry, and in this respect, the Climate Change Committee's sixth budget methodology assessment already identified that by 2050, around 8 to 25% of the demand in the industry could be covered by hydrogen. So overall, we see significant demand in or the potential of demand for hydrogen in the end sectors that could be from 19% to 24% of total end demand in 2050. So this is with respect to the first aim, which is, again, supporting decarbonization. As mentioned, we also heard, we also identified, especially from stakeholder engagement, the possibility of developing specialisms. And stakeholders in particular pointed out at four areas. Developing specialisms, for instance, in the production of e-fuels, so not only staying in hydrogen, but also developing clean diesel, clean jet fuel, that could be either used in transport sectors or in agribusinesses, like ammonia, for example. A specialism in technological development, or a specialism even in the manufacturing of hydrogen equipment. And when we looked, when our approach to these suggestions was to think about, so at the beginning is the fact that whatever priority or whatever additional objective is taken for the development in this sector should have in mind that in any case, it should be consistent with ensuring that the sector is fit for purpose. And what do I mean by this? Energy is the whole basis of the functioning of our economy. And a fit for purpose sector, energy supply, should ensure that supply is competitive and promotes the competitiveness of all the activities of the Northern Irish economy, as well as affordability. So against this background, we also thought, okay, let's assess these suggestions against initial conditions, potentials for competitive advantage. And from this very simplified approach, we say technology development sounds as a key area for developing specialisms. The other ones, we would suggest to do a more detailed analysis, which again, shows that whatever is done cost efficiently and is done ensuring that the green engine remains fit for purpose. So why technological development we have already been hearing Northern Ireland has very good examples, for example, B9 and Catogen, to mention some of the ones that we have been hearing today, set already a precedent of we are seeing lots of innovation in this field. It's an area where it is possible to differentiate easily, not only on cost terms, but also in other quality dimensions. And you can also build on the very good already networks for communication between the industry and the academia that have been already mentioned before. So this sets out the objectives for developing the economy, the sector. Then we thought, okay, so what are the barriers to develop this sector? And at the core of this is the point that this is a nascent sector. This means that production or whatever investments are still done in production are linked to externalities, learning externalities. And in simple terms, what economists we mean by this is private investment will be below socially desirable level. That's all it means. Because it is nascent, that means that transmission, distribution, storage also have to be either adapted or developed. And these won't take, or these investments here might be held up if there is no certainty on the supply and the demand side, right? And then demand needs to materialize. And this is a little bit of a difference with respect to what we saw in the case of renewables for the electricity sector. There was no need, I mean, people could continue using their light bulbs, their computers with green electricity. But with hydrogen, some sectors will need to incur into appliance adaptation, and that creates one-off costs. And that puts a bit of a pressure into bridging also the cost gap, because when consumers are going to switch, when consumers are going to incur in investments to have a new appliance, they would be thinking, okay, I have to do some savings, such that they also justify this upfront investment that I have done. So that sets kind of a bit of an additional pressure. And actually, that leads me to talk about this chicken and egg situations that we have been referring to before. The fact that customers would be, or demand will be thinking about lower costs to make the move puts a little bit of a barrier to lower costs, because to lower costs, we need to arrive to some scale. But the scale would arrive if costs are not lower. So chicken and egg situation. Chicken and egg situation because, again, investors won't invest if they don't see perspectives of demand. And as we mentioned before, investments in the infrastructure, in the transport and storage infrastructure won't occur if there are no perspectives of supply and demand. So what do we do about this? We have proposed the following action plan that considers from the near term to the long term to develop the sector. And as Peter mentioned before, we also think that wide system planning should be at the beginning of what is done. What is wide system planning? It's an exercise of looking at all the energy carriers, so not only hydrogen, but electricity and other energy sources, and thinking, okay, how can we have an energy supply that is cost efficient? And that analysis also takes into account geographical considerations. That will identify where are potential supply centers at low costs, where would be the demand. And that is very important information for the sector to coordinate investments and decisions. We think that support is also necessary. Peter also mentioned this. And in this respect, we think support hopefully would follow whole system planning. So whatever is done kind of that builds into hopefully enabling that coordination, if actually plans that in the projects that involve more than one part of the value chain are presented, the support would be very, or prioritizing support to those, for example, would already favor coordination. And more generally, in any case, support should bridge the cost gap, and it also should ensure that the demand also has this one-off costs covered to avoid that they are holding up their investments. Regulatory adaptation is also important to enable blending, for example, to prepare for network adaptation and rollout, for example, and certification, for instance, is very important to ensure that there is the possibility to drive the willingness to pay. At the end of the day, we are seeing this with electricity. If we don't have a stamp that says this is green, how would people pay more for this? So certification is very important as early as possible. We are also thinking about a hydrogen governance body, and we are seeing this in various countries, Germany, Morocco, to mention some. What this means is having a governance body that has the relevant ministries that can drive the development of the sector, and also a consultation body. So, as Peter mentioned also in his previous presentation, communication between stakeholders in the sector is important because a lot of the investments are held up because of lack, could be held up with lack of coordination. A consultative governance body where key stakeholders are also participating and talking to decision makers then supports into solving these coordination issues. And then having on time the hydrogen catapult that was identified also in the energy strategy is important to be sure that Northern Ireland keeps up pace with what is happening in other jurisdictions. In the medium term, in the medium term, the priority is not having the sector up and running, as is the near-term priority, but it is ensuring that further expansion can happen. How could that further expansion happen? For instance, harnessing storage potential in the electricity sector, and that requires also some modeling exercises and some kind of technical assessment to really identify the potential for seasonal flexibility. Encouraging growing markets, quotas, for example, could be implemented if, and only if, trade competitors are doing the same. Otherwise, it's kind of putting yourself into a position where the industry cannot compete. Regulatory adaptation if market power issues are observed. Then, in the long term, the priority is ensuring that markets work, and that means removing cross-sector distortions, so hopefully in the long term, any dedicated support mechanisms could be lifted, such that it's really prices that are guiding the decisions. Hopefully carbon prices doing so. So people really being mindful of the, because of a price signal, of the impact of their energy decisions. And as Claire mentioned, part of our analysis was, well, okay, we have identified barriers and enablers, we have identified actions, what for? What is the impact on the Northern Irish economy? And for instance, what would be the impact on unemployment? And yeah, of course, this will be a new sector, so new jobs will be created, and for that, focus on ensuring that training is available and that skills are available are important to create those jobs, and are also important to ensure that the sector can develop in Northern Ireland. And yet, however, we didn't want to focus here on those direct impact, direct jobs that can be created here, because quite honestly, the impact that the hydrogen economy will have on job creation would be significantly higher if it is ensured that it fosters, or it is that hydrogen, the sector's development helps having a fit for purpose green engine. And why would hydrogen be able to do so? Well, to start with, especially when it is done on a wholesale on a whole systems assessment, it could be one of the key parts of cost-effective decarbonization that could also favor competitiveness and alignment with customer preferences, even in other jurisdictions. Let's remember that in Europe, in the European Union, we're talking about a carbon tax adjustment mechanism, for example, that also takes into account the carbon content or the embedded carbon, even in the processes of the products that are entering the union. So that into ensuring or keeping the industry competitive. And it also, hydrogen also enhances security of supply. We have seen, again, the island have strong potential for renewables that can ensure that can mean domestic production of hydrogen. So that reduces reliance on imports or is compatible with this target of being energy sufficient, self-sufficient. In case that imports would be necessary, albeit we have heard that this is not the aim, just a reminder that the portfolio of suppliers for green hydrogen worldwide is way much more diverse than the one that we have observed for incumbent fossil fuels. So in case that was necessary, the risks are lower for just depending on one trading partner or supply. So I think our overarching message is hydrogen, developing a low carbon hydrogen economy supports the Northern Irish economy by creating a fit for purpose engine. And that is the main contribution and of the sector to Northern Ireland. Thank you.